Welcome back, everybody. Let's continue to talk about the one sample t-test. In general, we like the one sample t-test because it's almost identical to the one sample z-test. The only difference is that we can use the one sample t-test when we don't know the population standard deviation, sigma. The way we get around it is that we estimate the population standard deviation using our sample data. In other words, we use the sample standard deviation to estimate the population standard deviation. As a result, we're not able to compute the standard error of the mean, but we are able to compute an estimate of the standard error of the mean. But we learned that our estimated values aren't perfect substitutes for the population values. And as a result, the distribution of sample means that we're working with is not normally distributed. And to complicate matters, the distribution of sample means that we're working with changes shape based on the number of people or things that we're measuring. In other words, it changes its shape based on our sample size. That distribution becomes more normally shaped as our sample size increases, but it's kind of shorter and more broad in shape when the sample size is relatively low. As a result, our critical regions keep moving where they're located based on the size of our sample. But that's no problem, because we learned how to compute degrees of freedom, which is very easy to compute. It's simply the sample size minus one, and we're able to use that value and a t-table to find the critical values that we need. In other words, the one sample t-test is very similar to the one sample z-test, but there are some slight variations, and we need to get used to them, so let's go through a few examples. In this particular video, we'll go through the first example from scratch. Let's take a look. Here's the first example. You'll see that we're going to be going through the same four steps that we went through before. That's the beauty of the four-step hypothesis testing procedure. Although we're going to learn three different t-tests, we're going to learn analysis of variance, correlation, regression, chi-square, we're going to learn all kinds of inferential tests. But for all of those tests, we will go through the same four steps. So that's good news. It's going to feel comfortable. We're going to have this tool that's going to be very flexible. Let's switch views and work on this example together. Let's read through it. An education psychologist administered an optimism test to graduating college seniors. This is pretty common research. If people graduating are very optimistic about the jobs they're going to get, then our economy is usually doing pretty well. But if graduating college students are not very optimistic, it usually shows that our economy is suffering. Higher scores reflect more optimism about their future. Last year's class had a mean score of 56. So that's the mean from the entire population. We see mu equals 56. A sample of 25 seniors from this year's class produced an average score of 59. So that's the sample average. We see x bar equals 59. Of course, there's some variability to that data, and we see the sample standard deviation equals 10. Based on the sample data, can the psychologist conclude that this year's class is more optimistic than last year's class? We're going to test that with an alpha of 0.05, one-tailed. So we're in a common situation. I see a difference between last year's class with their mean of 56, and then a sample from this year's class with their mean of 59. So at least descriptively, it looks like this year's class is somewhat more optimistic. But there are two good explanations for that difference. One explanation is that the population of this year's class is indeed more optimistic, and that sample mean reflects it. Another explanation for the differences that we see is just sampling error, and that this year's class is no different than last year's class. Well, we're going to go through these four steps to see if we have enough evidence to effectively rule out sampling error as a viable explanation for the differences we see. Just by glancing this over, I can see I don't have enough information to do a z-test. In order to do a z-test, I need to know mu, the population mean, and also sigma, the population standard deviation. I do not know sigma. But from that sample data, we can easily compute the sample standard deviation, and we can use that sample standard deviation to estimate the population standard deviation. That's what we're going to do. But that also means we're not doing a z-test, we're doing a one-sample t-test. That's no problem. Step one is exactly the same. we're going to start with a null hypothesis compared to an alternative hypothesis. Remember, these hypotheses are always stated in terms of population parameters, mu. I always ask myself, mu what? Mean what? What are we measuring? We're measuring optimism scores. So let's put in some subscripts. I'm going to put in OPT as an abbreviation for optimism. And then I ask myself, this is the mean optimism score for whom? We already know the population mean optimism score for last year's class. What we're really trying to learn about is the population mean optimism score for this year's class. Remember, that sample that we collected data on, that always represents the population we're trying to learn about. We collected data from 25 seniors from this year's class. That must mean that we want to learn about the population of this year's class. To make that clear, I'm going to put a little slash TY for this year. Slash TY. You'll notice that we're being asked to do a one-tailed test in this situation. For our class, we've discussed in the past that when your results can go in either direction, it's probably smart to do a two-tailed test. So we'd ask ourselves, is it possible that this year's class is more optimistic than last year's class? Yes, that's possible. Is it possible that this year's class is less optimistic than last year's class? Yes, that's possible. So it really feels like we should be doing a two-tailed test. And we could. But keep this in mind, not everybody agrees with me. Some people think they're justified in doing a one-tailed test when they have a very clear prediction about the direction of the results. So let's assume in this case, we're talking about that type of situation. This researcher has a very clear prediction that this year's class is more optimistic than last year's class. In those situations, some people believe they should do a one-tailed test. Let's go ahead and do that. You might recall that when we do a one-tailed test, it's easiest to start with the alternative hypothesis because the alternative hypothesis coincides with the prediction. In this situation, we are predicting that this year's class is more optimistic than last year's class. So for the alternative hypothesis, we would write that the population mean optimism score for this year's class is greater than 56. Now it's easier to see what the null hypothesis should be, because the null hypothesis needs to cover every other possibility. So in this case, the null hypothesis would say the population mean optimism score for this year's class is less than or equal to 56. That's step one, my friends. Let's move on to step two. Step two is all about figuring out how much evidence do we need to reject the null hypothesis. We will mark off how much evidence we need in this distribution of all possible sample means. Keep in mind, this distribution is created based on the idea that the null hypothesis is true. It's also created based on these parent population parameters. What that means is that right here in the middle, we should find a mean that's equal to 56. On that axis right there, we'll be listing mean values, and then right below that, we'll be listing t values. If 56 was transformed into a t-value, it would equal 0. Of course, there's some variability in this distribution of sample means, and we know that that variability is measured by the estimated standard error of the mean. And the estimated standard error of the mean is denoted with an S sub X bar. You can see that we're going to need the estimated standard error of the mean in our formula for t. Here's our formula for the estimated standard error of the mean. Let's just go ahead and compute it now, and then we can label it in our distribution. The estimated standard error of the mean is based on two key factors. It's based on the sample standard deviation, and it's also based on the sample size. The sample standard deviation equals 10 points on that optimism scale, and our sample size equals 25. We need the square root of that. The square root of 25 is 5. 10 divided by 5 equals 2. So on average, these sample means differ from 56 by 2 points on that optimism scale. All right, now that we have everything labeled up, let's remind ourselves why we're here at step two. We need to locate the critical region or critical regions. We're doing a one-tailed test, so we have just one critical region. Remember, we are predicting that this year's class is more optimistic than last year's class. So I'm going to put that critical region, that rejection zone, on the right side of the distribution. That's because on this number line, the means that are more optimistic than 56 are on the right side of 56. Now we need to figure out what T value marks off that critical region. Let's remind ourselves, we're using an alpha of 0.05. That means we need to put 5% all in that one tail. We know that these T distributions change shape based on the sample size. So in order to find the T value that marks off 5% in the tail, we first need to compute the degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom is very easy to compute. We just take the sample size, n, and subtract 1. So in this case, our sample size is 25. 25 minus 1 is 24. So we have 24 degrees of freedom. Let's consult our t-table. Here is our t-distribution. We are doing a one-tail test with an alpha of 0.05. This says level of significance for a one-tail test. And here are all of the alpha levels for a one-tail test. We want this column right here where it says 0.05. Now I just want to move on down until I see 24 degrees of freedom. And in fact, right here in this row, I see 24 degrees of freedom. So when I take that row and I see where it matches up with this column, I see this value right here, 1.711. That will be our critical value. So let's write that in, 1.711. That was step two. Now we're ready for step three. In step two, we needed to figure out how much evidence we needed to reject the null hypothesis. In step three, we figure out how much evidence do we have. Because we need to figure out, where is 59? Is 59 one of these sample means that is likely to occur just by chance, just due to sampling error? Or in this distribution of all possible sample means, is 59 one of these sample means that is unlikely to occur just by chance? If we transform 59 into a t-value, we will know exactly where it is in that distribution. So let's do that next. For x bar, we're going to stick in 59. For mu, we're going to plug in 56. Remember, that value is always based on the value that's listed in the null hypothesis. So that looks at the differences that we're actually observing. There's a difference of 3 points between last year and this year. And we're going to divide that by the estimated differences we would expect just by chance, the estimated standard error of the mean, which in this case equals 2 points on that optimism scale. So in the numerator, we have 3. In the denominator, we have 2. That gives us a t value of 1.5. Right in the middle, we have a t value of 0, and our critical value is at 1.711. 1.5 doesn't exceed that critical value. 1.5 is somewhere right around there. Let's write that in. That would be a t value of 1.5. That would coincide with our sample mean of 59. It's clearly not in that critical region. It's clearly not in the rejection zone. And that key piece of information right there helps us answer the following questions. My first question is simply, is our sample mean in the rejection zone? And our answer is no. I now have 3 follow-up questions, and all of those questions should be answered the same way with a no. The first follow-up question is, should we reject the null hypothesis? No, we should not. So I'm going to check it off. We're going to continue to embrace it. That null hypothesis is telling us that the population mean optimism score for this year's class is the same as it was for last year's class. Any differences that we see are likely caused by sampling error. Next follow-up question, do we have statistically significant results? No, we don't. The results are not significant. So I'm going to put a little NS to remind us of that. The next follow-up question is this, is it possible that we're making a type 1 error? And the answer is no. Remember, a type 1 error is when we conclude we have statistically significant results and we're wrong. We conclude that we have differences between groups and we're wrong. We didn't conclude that we have any differences, so it's impossible to be making a type 1 error. There's one more thing I like to do before we write up our results in step 4, and that has to do with the probability of finding our results just by chance, because we have to pick between the probability being less than 5% and between the probability of finding our results just by chance being greater than 5%. Let me remind you that area equals probability. And our sample mean was in this large area right here. It was not in that small critical region. If our sample mean is in that large area, it should be associated with a large probability. What's large? A probability less than 5% or a probability greater than 5%? I hope you would agree that of our two options, what is large is a probability greater than 5%. All right, let's use all of that information to write up our results in step four. Here we are in step four. The first thing we need to do is discuss if we are going to reject or fail to reject the null hypothesis. Then we need to discuss our results in everyday language. At that point, we need to show how our results would appear in a journal article. And finally, we need to report the appropriate measurement of effect size, which should be Cohen's D. We decided that we were failing to reject the null hypothesis. So this is how I would put that in more context. I would say that our sample mean of 59 is not in the critical region. This sample mean is likely to be found if the null hypothesis is true, so we fail to reject the null hypothesis. Because in other words, this sample mean is consistent with the null hypothesis. This is exactly the type of sample mean we would expect to find if the null hypothesis was true. In everyday language, we might say there is insufficient evidence to conclude that this year's graduating class is more optimistic than last year's class. Now we need to show how this would appear in a journal article. We did a t-test, so we need to report a t-value. One thing that we report right along with it in parentheses is the degrees of freedom. The reason we do that is because when people are reading journal articles, they should be given enough information to look up everything they would need to know about the test that we performed. When we are doing a t-test, the only way that people can figure out what the critical value was is by knowing the degrees of freedom. So if we're going to give them all the information they need, we need to include the degrees of freedom. So we list that we have a T value with 24 degrees of freedom. That value equals 1.5 because we found a T value of 1.5. The probability of finding those results just by chance is greater than 5%. In other words, there's a high probability that the differences we found are simply due to sampling error based on a one-tailed test. Even though our results are not statistically significant, we did detect some type of an effect in here. Because most of us are not familiar with this particular optimism test, it makes sense to compute a standardized measurement of effect size. The most appropriate measurement of effect size in this situation is Cohen's D. This is essentially the same formula that we used for Cohen's D previously when we did a z-test, but because we don't know the value of sigma, instead of having a sigma in our denominator, we will divide by s. In other words, instead of dividing by the population standard deviation, we will divide by the sample standard deviation. It's still measuring the same thing. We're still looking at the differences that we're actually observing. There was a difference of 3 points, and we want to standardize that by dividing by the standard deviation. That will tell us how big is the difference that we observed in standard deviation units. And we can remind ourselves right over here, the standard deviation was equal to 10. So a difference of 3 points divided by 10 gives us a Cohen's D value of 0.3. And that's a relatively small effect size. Remember, it's hard to find statistically significant results when you have a small effect size and a small sample size. Essentially, we're trying to find something that's very small, and we have very little evidence to do it. All right, that's this example, and I think we've done enough for right now. The next time we get together, we'll work through the second example, and at that time, I'm going to show you also how to compute a confidence interval. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.